Welcome to the Hour of Power. I'm Bobby Schuller. Recently, my grandfather, Dr. Robert Schuller, passed away April 2nd of esophageal cancer. It was obviously very hard on our family and on this church community, but as the last few weeks have gone by, we've taken time to think about the incredible impact that this man had on the world. Today, we've put together a collage, a collection of some of the greatest scenes from the Hour of Power over the years. We want it to be a time in which all of us, all over the globe, can remember the great man that my grandfather was. Friends, we want you to know, now more than ever, we need your help and support because this is just the beginning. We believe that our potential and our opportunities are vast and big, and we want you to get behind us and help us. Thank you, and remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we.
Welcome to an Hour of Power. Each week at this time, we join Robert Schuller in an hour of inspiration for daily living. Learn how you can pack your life with the power of possibility thinking. Find the answers you've been looking for. Stay tuned. We have good news for you today.
This is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Yes, I believe we do have a toot and tell church, but this motor drive-in church is another idea. It is come in motors, you, and bring your pew.
Or what happened to the mother whose little boy blurted out the truth that his mother was a Sunday school teacher? And I said, well, that's fine. She must do a lot of good. But is there anything she does for fun? Does she have any hobbies? He says, yes, she plays poker.
And I'm so grateful that my country gave me the opportunity to go all over the world taking our message of love through the music that I have.
In this very room, there's quite enough love for one like me. There's quite enough joy for one like me.
It's an exciting and historic day here in Garden Grove, California. Thousands of people are arriving to celebrate the dedication of the Crystal Cathedral. We invite you to join Robert Schuller for a Christian experience in possibility thinking.
For today, Dr. Robert Harold Schuller, senior pastor of this magnificent Crystal Cathedral and Hour of Power Television Ministry worldwide. Today, this is your life.
And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very room. In this very room,
this very room,
there's quite enough love for all of us, and in quite enough joy for all of us.
I appreciate you inviting me here today because, Dr. Schuller, I've been watching you for, oh, so many years, and this is absolutely gorgeous, and I'm very, very thrilled to be here. Really. And the nice things you said about me was really terrific, just the way I wrote it.
Happy trails to you. Keep smiling until then.
You wear a hairpiece?
Not in Southern California. It's a beautiful day, so I put my top down. Does that make sense?
Is in this very room.
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 When I met Gorbachev, he said, I want you to come back and you and I have a talk alone. But when I came back a few months later, I said, why don't you meet our president, President Reagan? He said, I don't want to meet him. He wants war. I said, Mr. Gorbachev, you're mistaken. Well, why did he call us an evil nation? Well, I said, that was during election. I said, since then, he said, we must have peace with Russia. Why don't you meet him and size him up yourself?
Yesterday was your first time you actually ever shared your testimony, you told me.
Well, for crying out loud, of all the places in the world to start out, the Crystal Cathedral, just like start at the top, you know? No pressure.
As the Father hath sent me, even so I send you. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to the whole creation.
Do you have children?
Yes, I have two children and an adopted daughter.
Wonderful.
They're terrible children. What are you talking about? Wonderful. You don't know them? Oh, I'm sorry. No, they really are. They're really great. You can't break them. It's just terrible. Okay. Oh, he's a great straight man. This is wonderful. I'm sorry.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain.
On your lip, I'll get it. Where are you? So, hey, don't laugh because Marlon Brando kissed me on the lips once.
Did he?
And I've never been kissed on the lips by a man in my entire life till Brando. And I have to be honest with you, I can't stop thinking about him.
For as much as you, Robert, and you, Arvella, are fulfilling the commitment together according to God's holy ordinance of marriage, and have confirmed the same by making solemn vows before God in this company, I pronounce you husband and wife again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, what God has joined together and kept together for the last 50 years, He will surely keep together for eternity. Now, you may kiss your bride. You are happily married.
28 years.
Yeah, oh, that's great.
28 years. Which
probably doesn't seem like much to you.
Do I look that?
Well, no, it's no, oh, I didn't mean it that
thank
way.
Thank you. Thank you.
I
didn't know I looked that old.
I just
you
meant...
should stick. You should study some psychology, Doctor.
I just meant you've been at this marriage game a lot longer than I have.
Okay, 54 years, yeah, yes.
Your marriage is what mine wants to be when it grows up, okay?
We gather together today in answer to our president who has called us to come and pray and recommit our lives in this time of horrific, unparalleled tragedy. We've come to unite in prayer to Almighty God to protect, to guide, and lead us, and grant us courage. The World Trade Center is gone.
Yes, Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so.
God bless America, land that I love.
We'll be back.
I got it through my head, or got it through my heart. I felt that that is where God is calling me and every one of us to pray, from the heart, not from the head. This is where He can do His greatest work.
I'm certainly honored to be invited back a second time. You don't always get a second chance. And secondly, I came because of the respect that I have for the leadership that you have given to this congregation and this hour of power. And I am always inspired by this service, and I watch it whenever I'm in town, I can watch it. I know when it comes on in Atlanta. It doesn't come on the same time in other places. So I watch you and your son on a weekly basis, and I'm always inspired and uplifted. And the things that you're doing and the message that is being carried throughout the world is something that's so desperately needed, and thank you.
And I was raised in a religious family, and the cowboy preachers used to come through West Virginia and pitch a tent and preach and pass a plate and make enough money to go to the next town. And they'd keep score on how can they save more people than was saved by the previous preacher. And I'd get, saved two or three times a night. You always get drowned when they baptize you in the river, but that's just... that's just the way it was back in the hills of West Virginia.
Last night you said to me you were saved how many times before you got out of town? 20?
quite a few. I tell things the way I remember them. Sometimes that's not necessarily the way it happened.
There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. I guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go.
Well, without believing you are a very small creature, you are as great as your faith, and you are as small as your ego.
Thank you. Friends, we hope you're enjoying this program in memory of the life of my grandfather, Dr. Schuller. You know, I have had an amazing privilege to be able to carry on his legacy, to launch my own ministry from this platform. And we're getting letters from all over the world of people whose lives are being touched. This program goes into 11 languages around the world. Millions of people are seeing it. And if you want to partner with us and help us move into the next chapter of this ministry, please consider supporting us. We need your help. We can't do this alone. We need your love, we need your prayers, and we need your financial support, and we hope you'll consider doing it. Please consider supporting us financially. We need your help. And now, back to the program.
I spent my life building castles of dreams, reaching for each distant star. As tears clear my eyes, I finally realize happiness is where you are, and I'm still a part. I swear I'll always celebrate your memory. You'll live inside of me. Heaven holds the ones I love. I see your eyes twinkle in the skies above. My hopes are floating in the clouds. The wind repeats your name out loud. Oh, heaven holds the ones I love. At times I'm unsure why our hearts must endure all the pain. Great loss. Still, look what I've gained. I feel your kiss in the rain. It's your smile I miss the most, and I'm still a part of you. And you're still the biggest part of me. And I swear I'll always celebrate your memory and trust what's meant to be. Heaven holds the ones I love. I see your eyes twinkle in the skies above. My hopes are floating in the clouds. The wind repeats your name out loud. Oh, heaven holds the ones I love. And in my grief and disbelief, one thing I know is true.
Ah.
I had a dream. The dream came from God. It didn't start with me. To build a church, to spend all of my life in one place doing something beautiful for God. And I had no money. And one message we're going to continue to give to the world, after I am dead and gone, it'll still be given to the world. And the message is this, that if you can dream it, you can do it. If you can believe it, you can achieve it. And with God, nothing is impossible. And if the idea comes from God, only you can shuttle it or kill it. God knows more about our tomorrows than we know about our yesterdays. And that's why I'm an incurable, hopeful person. I mean, I'm addicted to optimism. I've got a faith that is sensational. I don't care who you are, where you live, what your religion is, that's not the subject. I'm not here to convert you. I'm here to share with you what I have. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ. Can I tell you what that does? All of you can be followers of Jesus Christ. Whoever you are, whatever your background or faith, become a believer in the Bible, which is still the most powerful, holiest book in the world, and read the Bible and follow Jesus Christ. I don't promote a religion. I promote a relationship. I don't promote a source of doctrines. I promote a person, Jesus Christ. Tough times never last. Never last. But tough people do. And I would just hope and pray that some of the words that come out of this well-traveled mouth will hit you where you need the help and give you what you need most, and that's hope. How do you come back to confidence when you've lost it? Believe in the God who created you. Believe in the God who never will let anything happen to you unless he can take it up, pick it up, turn it around, and make a blessing out of a tragedy. And your worst times will turn out to be your best times. I've lived long enough, so I look back on my life, and I don't think I've ever had bad luck. I went through trying times, troubling times, tough luck times, but when it was all finished and God was done with the whole thing, it was a blessing that came out of it all. Hallelujah. I'm persuaded that neither life nor death, nor things present nor things to come, whatever my troubles are today, whatever my troubles might be this coming week, I'm persuaded that neither life nor death, things present nor things to come, will be able to separate me from the love of God. That's where the bottom line comes in. If you know this kind of a God, and I do, and I know many of you do, life will be beautiful anyway. And you know that tomorrow's a new day. New opportunities will come to you. And many of you who are going through great trouble, you don't know it, but you're walking into what's going to be one of the greatest blessings of your life. Something good is coming out of your hurt, and it'll be a halo over your head. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a soul like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. When we bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
I think that we have a responsibility in Christendom. People may not be brothers and sisters in law, but they can be brothers in Christ and accept this great commission to save fallen humanity. And it is our responsibility to have the courage and the convictions to assume that responsibility.
How, with the rejections and the injustices that were exposed against your family and your friends and relatives, how did you happen to embrace Jesus Christ? I mean, you could have thrown out the whole thing.
Well, first of all, it was a result of the faith that my mother and father have, even to this present day. My outside world was hostile and mean, but my innermost world was full of love and power and positive possibilities, if you will. And I was taught by my mother and father that I was God's child, and when God made me, he was at his very level best. and that I had something to offer this world. Furthermore, as we really view the depths of the alienated, estranged, and segregated society, it seems to me that it became the responsibility of the bruised to rise above their circumstance, and in fact, to show the way of those who were dispossessed. For it is the hater who is the loser, and the lover who is the liberator.
Mother Teresa, today we're in Tijuana, Mexico. What are you doing here in Tijuana, Mexico?
Well, I have come here with the sisters and the fathers and all of us to give tender love and care to the poorest of the poor, to give Jesus to them, because they find they are hungry for love, hungry for bread also, but they are beautiful people just left alone, and I want to be His love, His compassion, His presence to them all.
You are a missionary.
Yes.
What is a missionary?
A missionary is a person who carries the word of God and the life of God and brings that presence through his works of love, through works of faith. So, because faith in action is love, and love in action is service, and love and fruit of service is peace. So that's why it is wonderful to put faith into a living action that comes from prayer.
Bob, God has honored and used you in the most remarkable way to reach people that none of us could ever reach. And we thank God for you.
Tell me, when did you first make a commitment that would lead you into this life's work of evangelism?
Well, it was in 1934, an evangelist came in our hometown of Charlotte, North Carolina, and I didn't have much to do with evangelists because we went to an associate Reformed Presbyterian church, and they didn't have an emphasis on evangelism. But he stayed for about 4 or 5 weeks, and finally one of the men that worked for my father asked me to go. And I went and I saw him open the Bible and preach right out of the Bible, and that was a new experience for me. And I went back night after night, and one night when he gave the call to come and commit your life to Christ, I went and I stood there and received Christ as my Lord and Savior. And I went home that night and knelt down beside the bed on the little dairy farm that my father had. And I knew that something had happened. I couldn't explain it. I couldn't put it in theological language, but I knew that God had done something in my heart, and that was the beginning.
Tell me, what do you think is the future of Christianity?
Well, Christianity and being a true believer, you know, I think there's the body of Christ, which comes from all the Christian groups around the world, or outside the Christian groups. I think everybody that loves Christ or knows Christ, whether they're conscious of it or not, they're members of the body of Christ. And I don't think that we're going to see a great sweeping revival that will turn the whole world to Christ at any time. I think James answered that, the Apostle James, in the first council in Jerusalem, when he said that God's purpose for this age is to call out a people for His name. And that's what God is doing today. He's calling people out of the world for His name, whether they come from the Muslim world or the Buddhist world or the Christian world or the non-believing world. They are members of the body of Christ because they've been called by God.
Do you remember how this television program called The Hour of Power got started?
Oh, I remember a few things about it. I remember when I was holding a meeting in Anaheim, and you came over night after night and would sit in the little trailer that I had there as an office, and we would talk and pray, and you had a great burden to reach people for Christ all over the world.
And you said, Bob, you should think about televising your church service.
Yes.
And I said, but it'd be too expensive. And I think it was either you or Fred Deitert who said, why don't you let God make that decision? Why don't you take it to God the way You, Billy, took your hour of decision to him in prayer in Portland, Oregon.
That's right.
Remember that?
I do indeed.
You put a fleece out.
That's right.
And so you and your folks prayed, and we prayed, that God would show us, without any PR, financial support to start this Hour of Power.
I remember that very well.
And it was out of that that this was born. And I think it was you or Fred Dinard who said, well, Billy's an evangelist calling people to make decisions, and Schuller, you're a full-time pastor, call yours the Hour of Power. That Hour of Power title came from you and Fred Dinard, didn't come from me.
Oh, my. And, well, I'm honored.
Well, you're not honored. You were used, as we all are used. But today, it's still reaching people, and the thought that you're with us today is just wonderful. I was profoundly influenced in my life by a man whom I knew as a friend before he became an evangelist. His name was Billy Graham. I was profoundly influenced by another minister who called me to begin this church 40 years ago and paid my first monthly salary. His name was Norman Vincent Peale. And then I was profoundly influenced by the Archbishop Fulton Sheen. No theologian ever brought psychology and theology together more effectively than he did. It became a model for me and inspired me to become a television preacher. He was the first. Millions of people today have never heard these lectures, these principles, and they are true, and they work. When I first wrote about the positive thinking principles of possibility thinking, I had not really tried it that long. What's happened since then? I look at the congregation. Why? Where are the kids that listen to these lectures? They're gone. Boy, one became an astronaut, David Leisma, who's ahead of all the astronauts today. I don't take credit for him, but he did grow up in this church. You bet he did. Oh, one became a baseball player, Bert Blyleven. And I'm talking about kids who sat there from childhood and listened to the power of possibility thinking. And they went off to win gold medals in the Olympics. Janet Evans, another member of this church. And they're in theater and entertainment and arts today. And they're into politics, both Democrats and Republicans. I kind of have a problem. I mean, arranging it so they don't all come to church here the same Sunday. Would you believe that in last week I got two letters, one from Bill Clinton, the president, saying, I hope to sit in your pews one of these days. And 2 days later from a Republican named, let's see what's his name, Robert Dole. I hope to sit in your pews one of these Sundays. Now, I guess we got to arrange it so they don't both come on the same day. Possibility thinking transcends politics, races, ethics, creeds, and theologies. If you've been listening to my series of messages on prayer last year, you'll know that possibility thinking is the first level of prayer. That's where its power comes from. It is possible. Nothing happens until somebody has a vision, a dream that's impossible. But wow, wouldn't it be great if it were possible? The story of my life is dreaming of dreams that are all impossible. Wouldn't it be wonderful if they could be made possible? Let me give you these 10 commandments for possibility thinking. Commandment number one, never reject a possibility because you see something wrong with it. Hey, there's something wrong with every good idea. Commandment number two, never reject a possibility because you won't get the credit. Hey, in my flagship book, I wrote the line, God can do terrific things through the person who doesn't care who gets the credit. Commandment number three, never reject an idea simply because it's impossible. Every truly great idea is impossible. That's what makes it stand out, because it hasn't been done yet. And that gives leaders an opportunity to be leaders and not imitators. Someone said to me, Schuller, I'll be glad to go along with it just as soon as I understand it. He said, you know, I'll become a believer, but I've still got some questions, and I won't become a believer until I get my questions answered. And I said, if you got all your questions answered, you couldn't become a believer, because a believer is somebody who makes a commitment before he has the answers. That's what faith is. Of course. Commandment number four, never reject a possibility because your mind is already made up. Hey, you know, I've learned a lot of theology from the architects that I've worked with, and I've worked with the greatest architects of our century. Louis Kahn said it, if I've got all the answers, I can be sure of one thing, some of my answers are wrong. That's humility. Commandment number five, never reject an idea because it's illegal. We've done lots of things that once were illegal. Listen to me carefully. Under no circumstances do you advocate or approve an illegal act. But there are lots of ordinances and regulations that need to be done away with to increase the opportunities for freedom of movement. Commandment number six, never reject an idea because you don't have the money and the manpower and the mental power or the muscle or the time to pull it off. Listen, the power of a vision and the power of a dream outpaces any obstacle. I have faced obstacles, money obstacles, I still do. Manpower obstacles, I still do. Because if I'm living by faith and following the guidance of God, He will give me ideas that are impossible, and I have to move to the edge and make the decision before I can prove I can pull it off. Commandment number seven, never reject an idea because it'll generate conflict. Hey, every new idea creates oppositions. Every new proposal offends someone. We had a church membership here, and when we decided to build the Crystal Cathedral, some of the members didn't like the idea, and they left. In a free society, every single great idea, if it's proposed, will generate conflict. This separates the leaders from the followers, the men from the boys. I've had a little experience. Commandment number eight, never reject an idea because it's not your style. It's not your way of doing things. Your way isn't important. Success is more important than style. What's important is, what's the right way? Learn to accommodate. Prepare to compromise. Plan to adjust. Readjust your budget. Compromise your taste. Accommodate your lifestyle. Because success is more important than style. Never reject an idea because it's not your style. Or never reject an idea because it might fail. You know the line, I'd rather attempt to do something great and fail than attempt to do nothing and succeed. Commandment number 10, never reject an idea because it's sure to succeed. You've got a heart, you can dream. You live in a free country, you can get an education. You've been rejected, hey, you can do anything you want to do if you look at the possibilities.
Wow, that was an amazing program. It, for me, brings back tons of memories. I just remember as a kid how great my grandpa was. We would fish all the time, my dad and my grandpa, some of my cousins. I even remember in the Crystal Cathedral when I came to help my dad when he took over after my grandpa. My grandpa still made time to meet with me and mentor me. I remember sitting up in his 12th floor office, and he would take hours to just invest in me. That was such a great experience for me because I realized that my grandpa wasn't just my grandpa, he was my mentor. He was someone that cared about my future. He wanted to see that I would carry on the work that he did, and I have, and I'm so grateful that I have that privilege. Friends, we're so glad you joined us today. We hope that this was a moment of encouragement for you, that you have a new perspective of new possibilities, as my grandpa might say. And we hope, as always, that you know God loves you, and so do we.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands has made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think of God his Son, not sparing, gave him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Oh,
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may God give you his peace in your going out and in your coming in your lying down and in your rising up, in your labor and in your leisure, in your laughter and in your tears, until you come to stand before Jesus in that day in which there is no sunset and no dawning. Amen.